to you by Penguin.
Motherland, written and read by me, Priya Joi. Prologue. Mama, 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 can I have that? I glanced up in the middle of the French supermarket we were in, meandering through highways of camembert and baguettes and Côte d'Aron, to see what Leela was pointing at. In among a carousel of film merchandising tat, the thing that caught her eye was a blonde Elsa braid from the Disney film Frozen. We'd moved to France when Leela was only 11 months old, to a village on the border with Switzerland that lay in the hinterland between the Alps and the Jura Mountains. For the most part, my kid was surrounded by white people in all-weather jackets and iron jeans. What did Leela think about her skin colour, I wondered, that she wanted a blonde hair extension? Did she think she was white? Was it true that children had no idea that people came in different colours? I'm happy to buy that for you, but don't you think it might look a bit odd, sandwiched onto your black hair, I asked, amused. I wish I had blonde hair, Leela let out a sigh. You mean you want to dye your hair blonde one day? I replied. It was then that my caramel-coloured child told me how she really felt. A confession that made my entire being implode, like a dying star running out of energy, collapsing in on itself. She crinkled her nose, and then, cautiously, somehow sensing the impact it might have, revealed this heart-stopping confession. I want to be peach. I don't think brown skin is... She searched for the right word before settling on beautiful. This was my first inkling that my daughter was not entirely at peace with the way she looked. At first, I wasn't sure she really meant it, that perhaps she was trying out a thought like kids do, rolling it around in their minds like a marble to see where it lands. Because it didn't fit the idea I had of her. Leela has always been a bold and confident kid who strides through the world like she owns it, the embodiment of female empowerment. So, what's with this dissatisfaction with her skin? Her words played back to me, this time without the pause. I want to be peach. Holy hell. Deep breath, I thought. Don't panic. Leela, we come from one of the older civilizations in the world. We come from a land where billions pray to mighty warrior goddesses every day. They're all brown. So people in India aren't peach? There's lots of different shades of brown. There's light brown, dark brown, peachy brown even. Your skin tone is just another colour in your crayon box. She shrugged. I still want the Elsa braid. Maybe it was a bit much to expect a four-year-old to engage in a discourse over her ancestry in the middle of Carrefour. I don't know if what I said was the right way to respond, but I felt weary to my bones to still be living in the kind of world that has drip-fed the notion of white superiority into my girl's subconscious. Through predominantly white Disney princesses, to rarely using brown or black characters in advertising, to band-aids that are putty-coloured, over and over, the drumbeat to our lives is that white is most desirable. Even when we try to resist this indoctrination, it seeps in. Mama, Leela was looking up at me with giant brown eyes, holding up the blonde Elsa braid, tugging on my jacket pleadingly. Can we buy it then? I was a million miles away. Leela was slapping the side of my thigh more urgently now. How could my kid understand how the planets revolve around the sun and yet be unclear on where she fitted in? I had to find a way to make her proud of her heritage and be bold enough to strut into the world knowing who she is, not wishing she was born as something different. I wanted her to feel comfortable in her own skin, and to do that, I needed to help her reconcile her race and skin colour with her identity as a half-Indian, half-Bangladeshi, British kid growing up in France. I needed to counteract the societal messaging by injecting enough self-worth and belief in her so that she never thinks of herself as lacking in any shape, form, or colour. But to do that, I was going to have to start with myself. Chapter 1. You can't be what you can't see. From the age of 7, I had one of those diaries that comes with pages designed to be filled in with your favourite things. Colours, foods, hobbies, what you wanted to be when you grew up. My career ambitions yo-yoed wildly from being a model or flight attendant, which I referred to in the more 1980s lingo of air hostess when I was 7, to being a plastic surgeon, reconstructive rather than cosmetic, I noted in my diary, or a laboratory researcher when I was 15. Reading back through those pages decades later, I'm startled by the shift in my ambitions between early childhood and adolescence. It makes sense considering by the time I hit puberty, I was an asthmatic, thick glasses-wearing science nerd. I was a Seinfeld fan who loved English literature as much as maths and physics. Not exactly the groundwork for a glamorous career that would involve slinking around fashion shoots in a silk spaghetti strap dress or trotting down the aisle of a 747. Mum signed me up for an extracurricular group called Alternatives back when we lived in Bangalore. It was run by a couple who'd been trained in creative and critical thinking with a mind to encourage Indian teenagers, who go through a rigid educational system of rote learning, to think a little differently. We had a crash course in everything from art, discussing provocative artists like Picasso, to music, dancing around to Bob Marley's Buffalo Soldier in both political understanding and groove. I doubt Mum knew exactly what the course involved, but my parents have always been encouraging of me and my sister trying out anything we wanted to. Between us, over the years, we did ballet, classical Indian dance, tennis, rock climbing, and piano and guitar lessons. Looking back, my life in Bangalore was so much freer. I used to take rickshaws all over the city from the age of 14, and more progressive with classes like Alternatives than my subsequent life in England. When I moved back to England at 16 in the early 1990s, everyone in my school wore Doc Martin boots, long floaty skirts and messy hair as an homage to the reigning king of grunge, Kurt Cobain. In India, Nirvana hadn't quite taken off in the same way just yet, so I rocked up in my Garfield t-shirts and a padded hairband, which I would wear with a quiff that paid bizarre homage to Elvis. Needless to say, I stood out. There's an old joke that South Asian children have the freedom to choose whatever career path they want, as long as it's a doctor, engineer, or lawyer. I mean, there's nothing wrong with these as occupations. It makes sense that immigrants want their children to have jobs with security, ones that will always be needed regardless of the state of the economy. But for so many young Asians who get rooted into these careers, irrespective of whether they wanted to be an artist or a writer, it narrows the field acutely. Even though my parents had never been this overbearing with me and my sister, and generally encouraged us to follow our hearts, the reason I felt so unable to imagine anything beyond an academic career is clear when you look at the role models that teenage me had, or rather the abysmal lack of any sort of representation for Asian, Black or Latina girls. This list is everyone I could think of and, as you can see, it isn't South Asian specific, but includes anyone remotely resembling my skin tone. We couldn't be picky back in those days. 1. Jasmine from Aladdin. The turquoise blue-clad Princess of Agrabah was the first Disney princess of colour in the 1992 animation. She was pretty badass, running away from the palace and escaping her domineering father and conniving advisor Jafar, all in search of freedom. Jasmine was curvy and dusky-skinned enough to seem relatable. But what with her being royalty, having a tiger as a pet, and marrying the Prince of Persia and all, she wasn't exactly someone I could realistically aspire to be. 2. Aishwarya Rai, Miss World 1994. Aishwarya was as unattainable a role model as the animated character of Jasmine, but this was one of the first times I can remember an Indian woman being talked about in the West as being a great beauty. She also wasn't stick thin, which made her seem more relatable. 3. Scary Spice, Mel B. One of the most blatant.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.